You are listening to Social Europe Podcast. We discuss cutting-edge thinking on politics, economy, and employment and labour with some of the most thought-provoking people around, including Nobel Prize winners and other internationally acclaimed experts. So welcome and enjoy the conversation.
This episode of Social Europe Podcast is brought to you by the New School for Social Research. The New School for Social Research is a world-renowned graduate school in New York City, offering master's and doctoral programs in the social sciences and humanities. New School students and faculty work to understand social problems through progressive interdisciplinary scholarship and create new ideas in the world. To learn more about the New School for Social Research, visit newschool.edu/NSSR. Katharina Pistor, thank you very much indeed for joining me today to talk about the topic of your most recent book called The Code of Capital. And I thought it was a very interesting take because usually capitalism is viewed through the lens of economics, but you take a legal view to the subject and you start the book with the chapter on what you call the empire of law. What exactly do you mean by the empire of law?
So let me just maybe start by saying that I'm not the first one who looks at capitalism through the legal lens. You could say that Karl Marx did that, right? He talked about property rights a lot and viewed that as the foundation of capitalism. And then John Commons, writing in the 1920s, wrote a book on the legal foundations of capitalism. So it's been a trend, but an overlooked one. When I talk about the legal empire, I'm really talking about the way in which, in particular, the institutions of private law, that is property rights and contract law, corporate law, trusts, the common law trust law, and bankruptcy law, can be used by private parties to organize their private relations by basically piggybacking on the coercive powers of the state. Without the state having to give its ex ante approval, it's basically underwriting private law. And it could be challenged in a court of law eventually, but you have a lot of flexibility in structuring your private relations by using these institutions of private law. And that has been done extensively, much more flexibly, perhaps in the common law jurisdictions than in the civil law jurisdictions, but still there too. And I think in the age of globalization in particular, they have the asset holders and their lawyers have gained even greater flexibility in picking and choosing the law that they like best to code their assets as capital.
And how exactly does it work? So how are these assets legally coded? And maybe this follows up quite nicely from the most recent discussion we had with Guy Standing, who's just wrote a book about the plunder of the commons, where what was seen as the property of the commons has been more and more commodified and privatized. How exactly does this work?
So it works slightly different for different types of assets, for different types of objects. But the classic case, of course, is land, right? And we know that in England, land was enclosed in the 16th and 17th century. Some of the literature focuses on the big legislation that enclosed the land, but the legislation was actually very late. So what I focus on in the book is the process in the 16th century when about two-thirds of all arable land in England was enclosed, very much in a one-on-one basis. It's case by case. It's basically a landlord asserting better rights over the commoners. And then the commoners challenge that and they fight back. And at first, the dispute is carried out on the land. I mean, they're building fences and they're building hedges and the commoners break the fences and they tear down the hedges and they plow the grass that they have sown for the sheep herds, etc. So there's a physical battle, but in the end, everybody goes to court because the landlords are saying we have the better right, and so we want to invoke state power to keep the commoners out of our land. And that also goes back and forth. They don't win every case. They don't win immediately every case. But over the course of a century, they convince the courts that they have seniority. They have simply a better right, that they always had a better right. They just allowed the commoners to participate. And they also made sort of other moves, like they challenged the standing of commoners in court, etc. So it's a battle where you build arguments that others find, or the courts might find persuasive, that other parties then use to claim their own rights and make a case in court. And when you look at it closely, you can also see, of course, that the landlords probably had the upper hand from the beginning. They were literate. They had probably the better lawyers. The proceeding was typically in writing, so the commoners had to go and document to a clerk. But this is basically how it works. You challenge these rights. It's a peaceful battle, largely. I mean, there was a physical as well, one as well. But it's basically carried out in the law, and the law, in this case in particular, over time, sided with the stronger party.
So basically, if I understand you correctly, not being a lawyer myself, so this interpretation basically seeped into the system with different precedents and cases, and you know, you build a body of law that then serves to, you know, shift gradually in a certain direction.
Yes, a seeping is really a good word here. I think it's not a big design. It's not an easily told conspiracy theory, but there is sort of this, so you seed these ideas and these concepts, and then they are being picked up, and then gradually they're diffusing throughout the legal system. And then again, in an era of globalization, they can also basically be made portable and be carried from one legal system to another.
And you also make the case that different legal devices and even different legal systems are used to codify these type of different assets. I mean, how would you explain that sort of use, and what type of different assets are codified? You mentioned the classic case of land, but that has obviously developed over time.
Yes, I mean, I think we know this, and we know this in part from Thomas Piketty's data, that there has been a metamorphosis of the assets that are the source of most of the private wealth that is created. And we start with land. And he has very nice data that show that in England in particular, rural land was the most important source of wealth that was coded in capital at the time, and then gives way to other assets. And these assets are mostly financial assets today. Shares, bonds, and much more complex financial assets, as well as intellectual property rights and urban housing, urban land, which is also finance-based. So it is being fed by, I think, credit assets in particular. So how does that process work? There is, of course, a change in demand and supply, as Piketty would explain it, and there's a technological change. But there's also, in parallel, this is what I want to hone in on, a change in the coding, because with these assets, these new financial assets, intellectual property rights, they need their own attributes of capital. And the attributes of capital that I think cut across the different assets are priority. So you have priority claims, better claims over others. You can make them durable. You can basically protect your assets against too many groups of creditors. You can convert your assets, ideally on demand, into safer assets. And then last but not least, that's really the critical thing, you can piggyback on the state powers to make these claims universally enforceable. Anybody has to yield to these claims, even though they might not have been at the table when the bargain was struck, because the state says, this is a right I recognize and I will enforce against anybody. So what I'm basically telling in the book is the story how each asset was coded, right? So there's this enclosure movement. And then we're talking about firms, right? You have a kind of a simple firm. You can run a business. You don't need the law to do that. But if you want to protect your family assets from your business assets, you need a legal shield. And that's what the trust gives you and what the corporate form gives you. And then if you want to invite others to participate in your business, you want to give them some kind of a membership right, but they also want to have their money, so you issue shares. Right? And then the shares give you something, certain types of rights that are coded in law, but also protect the shareholders from liability. That's the limited liability, right? So I'm basically going then asset by asset to show that the same kind of attributes that I talked about, priority, durability, convertibility, universality, are coded somewhat differently for each of these assets, but we see them again when we look a little closer. And that's how the process basically unfolds over time. And it is ongoing, right? You might even outrule some assets, and then a new one is created with the same types of mechanisms. And I should say a word about the mechanisms. I talked about the attributes. What I'm also saying in the book, that we basically have used only a handful of legal institutions to do the coding, to basically graft these attributes onto assets. And these are property rights, collateral law, trust, common law trust law, corporate law, and bankruptcy law. And then contract law can mimic many of the features, so it's very important as well. But these are really the core institutions. And so you can show how these institutions were used time and again basically to graft these attributes onto different asset classes.
And basically, in a sense, also create assets out of thin air. I mean, if it started with land, obviously the supply of land is limited. There is only so much to go around. So, and you mentioned how this is moved into different areas, and most recently, obviously, especially in finance, a lot of you're based at Columbia University. I'm sure you have a lot of insights into what is happening in Wall Street, but especially a lot of these, even some of these contracts might not be called assets after all, right? Because the liability question is maybe not as clear as one would have thought. So, but you know how has this actually developed into these assets? I mean, nobody knows the volume, for instance, of derivatives anymore, because the over-the-counter contracts, they're not registered in the settlement, Bank of International Settlements and things like that. So, I mean, how has this really mushroomed so much out of control?
Yeah, so this is a great question. Let me just first start by saying you really hit the nail on its head, right? So we now the most important capital asset that we have today are themselves creatures of the law. They do not exist outside the law. So land, land is sort of out there. It's a real physical thing. It's a piece of dirt. And we can code it as capital by creating property rights in land, et cetera, et cetera. But a financial asset exists only in law. It exists only because we make a binding contract that is enforceable against a third party. So there are a couple of elements that are really important in explaining why the financial sector has mushroomed so much. One, of course, is that there has been just a lot of innovation, also legal innovation, in using existing legal elements like contract law and collateral law and property law and do new things with them. You know, what is securitization? That's sort of what brought us into the mess of 2008 with securitized mortgages, with securitized loans and receivables and everything that we could securitize. When you securitize, you basically buy claims to future cash flows and you throw them behind a legal shield, a trust. So when in the finance jargon, people talk about special purpose vehicles, in legal terms, this is either a trust or a corporate entity, and for good reasons, because then you get the legal shield that separates these assets from other assets and that creates certain priority rights to these assets for some. And that makes sure that they are certainly protected in bankruptcy from rules of bankruptcy, even by lobbying legislatures. So all these moves were made to make it possible that a simple contractual claim, a claim to future payment, is actually converted into a tradable asset that people buy and treat in their own imagination as an asset. Because the law treats it as an asset. It makes it enforceable on the other end. The problem to some extent, of course, is that people then have mistaken this kind of legal certainty that they have an enforceable claim for actual delivery. Because what the legal enforceability doesn't give you is the promise that there will be assets left in the hands of the debtor when you finally want to enforce. So it does create a huge illusion, right? But I want to say that these assets are actually assets. And let me just add one thing, which is really important. In the beginning of the 20th and the end of 19th century, you can already see this, is that courts in the United States and increasingly in other countries have said that property rights is not only about using the particular thing. That's how property rights first emerged. It was about land, it was about cows, it was about a plow. But then it increasingly became a claim to future returns. It was an expectation that was then protected as property right. Once you have that as a legal matter, you can code anything as capital if you want, right? And is, of course, it doesn't have the materiality, but in terms of expectations to future cash flows, this is an asset. And our entire, I think, global capital system consists of these types of assets. They are coded in law.
I mean, I think one very, very interesting element here is that, as far as I can see, obviously you have a contract between counterparties and there's a direct relationship. What the legal view does not take into account is actually the whole value chain and the incentives, how the incentives are changed in the system. I mean, people who might listen to this might know the movie The Big Short. What happened, especially in the United States with the mortgage crisis, was that given that, you know, banks or mortgage originators knew that they would get rid of the mortgages of their books by selling them on in one way or the other, the incentive to give out more and more risky mortgages has just increased, right? And the likelihood of a default increased. And down the chain, I mean, from an economic analysis point of view, you increased information asymmetry, because in the end, because they were sliced up and repackaged and so often times, in the end, there was no more, the contractual relationship between the lender and the borrower was at the bottom of the chain, but that information was no longer reflected in any meaningful way in the product that was six or seven products down the line.
Well, that's what we found out later, and I agree with you in one way. But I think, you know, many people would argue, and many economists would argue, that law is all about creating incentives. Right? So we meet somewhere. So the question is, you know, what kind of incentives, and do we understand all the implications of the incentives that we're creating? Because the other side of the story that you're telling is basically that we want to diversify risk, right? So that's why you basically pool all these assets and you throw them in a special purpose vehicle. And then what the law does, from my perspective, is create incentives for the investors to buy that stuff, right? So you basically were telling the stories of the originators of the mortgages, who were basically not taking care anymore about what they were buying because it was just a pass-through model. But I'm basically saying, well, what makes investors on the other end buy that stuff is because they think that they have an enforceable asset in their hands. And they know that some of them are risky. They're paying for risk as well, right? The securitizer, assets were tranched, as they called it. They created different claims for different investors. Some wanted safety, they got the senior tranches. Some wanted high yield and took the risk, they got the junior tranches. And that meant basically if you had senior, you would always get the cash flow first, and you would always be the last one to get the losses. And when you were junior, you were in just the opposite. So that's what law and the contractual devices they used to create them did as well. And so this whole thing was packaged in legal incentives. And you could say, well, we overdid it. As I said before, what was lost somehow in translation, in the legal translation of these claims, was that actually there might not be anything left at the end of the day. And it might be that this entire scheme was driving up asset prices because investors were naively buying up that stuff and thought it could go on forever, when in fact there was a crunch on the other side, that the homeowners couldn't afford it, and that real estate prices would not rise forever.
Yeah, I mean, the basic principle is of course right, that you try to diversify risk by repackaging, and it's also fine that you do sort of AAA rated mortgages with lower ratings, but as long as the original information is contained. As soon as you lose original information, you're actually creating a risk. If information is lost along the way, and that's why the pricing structure effectively broke down, because the risk assessment was no longer a reflection of the actual risk, which only Correct. Became apparent when the bubble burst.
Correct. You know, I agree with that. I think I think part of what the law, of course, does, it insulates sort of risk from others, and that was the purpose. Why we say we're creating a special purpose vehicle that is insulated legally from the sponsor of the special purpose vehicle, so that the investors don't have to care about it, because it was basically supply side. So it was a supply of assets for investors who were looking for safe assets, right? And you basically sort of structured these assets so that the investors would buy them. But it also, of course, implied that the investors could not possibly know what was going on at the other end. And that, you know, when they finally realized, that's when these assets became toxic. That's when nobody wanted to hold it anymore, because they realized they didn't really know. But before that, we pretended that you knew, and you could have known more had you cared. So if you look at the legal documents for securitization, 300 plus pages, and they grew from 60 in the pages in the 1970s to 300 plus, and most of the growth came from more sophisticated designs, but also from a longer and longer list of risk factors. It's all, you can all read it. Nobody did.
Yeah,
but the lawyers knew.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, if you have a CDO, a structured CDO, and there were thousands of mortgages underlying it, nobody's looking into each individual mortgage, right?
So, except for in The Big Short,
Exactly, they did.
The guy reads it, and then he finds out. And actually, I wanted to say that I always watch the movie with my students when I teach my seminar on this stuff, and we always zoom through the movie. We're only looking at sort of the legal things. What is a swap? What is an ISTA? Do we understand the structure? There's always a deep legal structure hidden behind that, that of course doesn't, you know, it's not shown in the movie, but it's sort of alluded to, and you can go and look at it if you want.
Yeah, no, it's a very good description of what actually happens, and sort of very easy to follow and understand. So, but I mean, what it strikes me, and as I said, for me, the biggest problem there is, of course, these legal vehicles are, they're very useful if they're used appropriately. right? And but the appropriate use is very hard to determine, and especially given that, you know, you only notice mispricing after the crash. Let's put it that way, right? So there's no a priori way of knowing this. So you, as a legal expert in this space, how would you say, where is the good balance? You know, how can these devices be used for good? And you know, where is it turning into a dangerous game?
Yeah, you know, I think, you know, much can be said, of course, for securitization and for diversifying risk. And when I look at the early securitization structures, they made a lot of sense to me. They were actually still structured with the idea of lowering the costs of credit and making it easier for homeowners to buy, which was the original idea, right? Securitization started in the US really in the late 1960s with a change in the law that encouraged the government-sponsored entities, Fannie Mae in particular, and Ginnie Mae, to start securitization. It changed dramatically when the private sector came in, because the private sector used it as a capital mint, as I say in the book, right? So so at the beginning, everybody who was investing in this pool was basically getting the same slice, and they got basically a risk slice throughout the entire pool, and also knew that they didn't know certain types of assets or the risk, certain types of risk. Once they started the tranching, I think they were able sort of to create the illusion that there are assets that are really AAA if you just are in the upper rank here, if you're a senior tranche, and you can get more yield when you're in the junior. Then they always had problems with the mezzanine tranches because nobody wanted to be in that bracket. And then they started creating the CDOs. Basically, they created their own buyers in law and found investors that put money into them so they could buy these mezzanine tranches that then also were tranched so that they also had AAA, right? So once you get into that game, you lose control, right? So I think original diversification with securitization in the simple model did a lot of good and was sensible. And once it was just carried through to becoming a capital mint, basically to supply the entire financial sector with an endless supply of safe asset, which is impossible. We can all understand that immediately, but created that illusion. It had to create a bubble and it had to burst. So I think we have to understand these kind of this trend towards ever greater risk taking through competition and complexity. And I think I would hope that regulators would have a better handle on that. Now, I guess they don't. To the contrary, we're even sort of going back into the mode of saying, you know, they know what they're doing and we're relaxing the stress tests, et cetera, et cetera. But I think that's where I would just draw the line. It's not only a matter of complexity, it's also a matter of flipping the purpose for it's supply side. That's because you want to make profit, and rather than serving the ultimate need, which was actually to lower credit for homeowners.
Yeah, I mean they're basically just serving a demand. I mean, if you look at some of the most liquid investors, pension funds and the like, they're only allowed to invest in AAA assets, because of their own regulation. So basically, if you want to tap into that market, you have to supply AAA assets. But I mean, I haven't followed it in the last 18 months or so, but I mean, what has happened? Has anything happened with the rating agency yet? Because you know, being at least more diligent at the level of applying these ratings might be the first step.
Yeah, I mean, too little has happened. I mean, we have sort of relaxed sort of the direct dependence on ratings for regulatory purposes, so that if you have AAA, then you're fine. But so the state regulations don't tap as much into the ratings anymore. But in the end, what investors or financial engineers also want is the simplification of information. They want to look at the AAA rather than at the reading 300 pages of a proxy contract. And we all understand that, but that's another friction here. It's another point where a lot of important information is simplified to a point where it becomes meaningless, and then investors respond to that. But there is, as you know, there is no real competition in this field, and nobody dared really to take on the big rating agencies, and nobody knew what the alternative would be. There was debated, but this was never really thought through or some major reforms made. Yeah,
there was a debate about creating public rating agencies,
yes,
right?
Correct.
So, but that was never followed through.
But it was also an issue, sort of, you know, which public agency has the independence to rate them assets across borders, etc., right? Not that the private ones are necessarily always independent and not biased. That's a problem too, right? But I'd rather have a multiplicity of agencies rather than, let's say, a single public one. That's a tall order to create.
So, and you're basically saying that we haven't made any progress in trying to not rein in, but sort of deal in a more responsible manner with these types of legal instruments.
The problem is, and that's something that I try to explain in the book as well, you know, it's not that you can have a one silver shot solution to this and then it won't happen again. This is basically, you know, it's a capitalism sort of competitive system. It's not only a competitive market, sort of the competitive advantage that you get when you're talking about assets that owe their very existence to law, is to use law to create new ones and to reduce the cost of regulation. So one of the regulatory reforms that was introduced after the crash was, for example, this idea of skin in the game. So first we took out the banks. They basically no longer held the mortgages. They were pass-through models, as we discussed earlier. Now we say, well, we want you to have skin in the game because then you have better incentives to assess risk. Well, then the lawyers start working on how you get around the cost of having skin in the game. So you can fake having skin in the game without having skin in the game. And that has happened, of course, because the clients don't want to have skin in the game. And the lawyers know how to do that. So there's
no lawyer-proof way of doing it?
There's no lawyer-proof, no. They're just too sophisticated to do that. It's basically, they tell you that. If you're friends with them and you talk to them, they also will tell you. It's becoming more complicated, but in the end, they can mute any public regulation. If you have the right legal tools, you can basically reduce or mitigate the cost effects of almost any regulation if you're smart enough to do so. And that's also not so surprising because every economist knows that contracts are incomplete. Of course, law is incomplete. It's much more incomplete than contracts are, right? So, and the lawyers write the contracts and the lawmakers have the law. So the lawyers basically exploit the gaps in the legal scaffolding to create new assets and intermediaries that are not bound by the same rules. It has to be legal. So I'm coming back to my the empire of law, right? So they have to fit these new assets and entity through the gaps of the existing regulatory constraints because they need enforceability. So it's not always easy to do that, and we shouldn't be surprised that they earn so much money. They are creating value. They are creating new assets that can be capitalized with the same logic that I explained before, and they're doing it.
There's no way for regulators to catch up and be one step ahead. They're always going to be lagging behind.
I think this will always be the key question that we have is whether we have floodgates open to do so or whether it's a trickle open to do so. You cannot ever close the trickle. And maybe we don't want to either. Maybe we want to have some innovation, and maybe also not all regulation turns out to be exactly right, etc. Right. So I don't want to close it off, but I think, especially, again, I come back to the theme of globalization. If I can't get around the rules of my current regulator here, well, maybe I can do the same stuff in London, right? Or maybe I can do the same stuff in Hong Kong. And so my client just has to book his assets to a different account somewhere else and do the same thing there. And then because we have this underlying network of the recognition of foreign law and its enforcement in our home shores as well, even if you do it then in a different jurisdiction, it might be enforceable in the United States, even though you have done a complete runaround of, let's say, the US regulation or the German regulation, whatever it might be. Given that, right, so this is when we opened the floodgates since the 1970s by removing capital controls, by giving lawyers much more ability to pick and choose the law that they want for the assets that they are coding, we have just lost control over it. And I think that's where I would start closing the chutes a little bit and making sure that there's greater control at the territorial level over the law that's available.
Okay, so, and also controlling cross-border capital flows?
You know, I'm not absolutely against that. I mean, I've always thought that under certain conditions, countries should keep their capital controlled at a certain level. This is also not a on and off, right? You can allow capital inflows for certain types of transactions and not for others. Of course, they always also know again how to get around this. You use swaps and other instruments to do so. So they've become quite sophisticated. But the regulators have also become more sophisticated. So I think Brazil found ways to deal with sort of the sophisticated response to its capital controls. So I think under certain conditions, it makes perfect sense for a country to protect itself. And not only from outflows, which was the old story, from inflows, from the tsunami of new capital coming onshore, because that's where they find yield right now. So yes, it's one of the toolboxes that states have to protect the interests of their public.
Yeah, I mean, they're obviously the big cannons you can use. I mean, remember former German Chancellor Helmut Schmidt once said that you can eradicate the problem with tax havens in one day. Just ban them, any company from being registered in a tax haven, from trading in Germany, say.
Here we go. And I think this is, I was saying something very similar in my book. I'm basically saying, why is it that we recognize corporations that are only shell corporations? We all know that they're shell corporations. They have no employees. They have the same board of directors as every other shell company in the same jurisdiction. It's all faked. Why do we give them the status of a legal entity? Just withdraw that, and then basically automatically all their assets would be accounted to the owner, which is the parent company or another subsidiary in the system. And that might be actually easier, more effectively done than trying to go after the tax havens, because you will always have some countries that will position themselves as tax havens. But if the tax authorities in Germany or France are sort of saying, we'll just cut right through, that's a different matter.
Yeah, I mean, so that's a very straightforward argument that he put forward. I mean, it's interesting, we're coming into the area where, what can policymakers actually do? And we recently had also discussion about tax havens, about in the area of corporate taxation. Well, I mean, one of the proposals that is currently being discussed in the OECD level, and at the G20 there was also some movement, is the effective minimum taxation. Which would basically eradicate all incentives to use tax havens. So if you found a way to basically say you pay 20% tax anyway, no matter where you're based, it doesn't make any sense anymore to be based on the Channel Islands or Isle of Man or something like this. So that's quite interesting. And also I wanted to ask you about, in terms of innovation, potentially the loss of information of the underlying asset is one of the problems down the chain. Could you see innovations such as private blockchains or anything like that providing new ways of creating transparency where previously transparency was very hard to come by?
Yes, I think, I think we are at the cusp of sort of seeing very different types of assets, and also, as using the blockchain, not only, for creating, let's say, new coins like Bitcoins and others, but also using it as a repository of information that is accessible, at least if you're on that chain, so you can sort of look back at all, every step. But I mean,
a private blockchain, it's not public blockchain.
It's a private project. It's a private project. So I'm not a technologist. I mean, I think what they're currently looking at is basically whether you have the assets available to make your purchase, for example, right? So the question is basically what kind of information will be accessible. So that's a question for the coding, right? And it's not that fundamentally different from what we've done in the law. We have decided that certain types of information should be made available to the public, right? And for that we have created regulators. And I think what the blockchain coders have to think through, and what regulators of them have to think through, is what type of information should be contained and should be accessible to different parties. Because that's, if it's possible to do this, we could do it. But of course, we never do exactly what might be the best for the public interest. We typically do what is best for those who are trying to increase their wealth through these new technologies.
Yeah, and towards the end of our conversation, because we've already been going for almost half an hour, it is very clear that there is potential political fallout from, as we've seen in the economic and financial crisis. So, and, given that we predominantly talk to stakeholders in the policymaking area, where would you start if you were a policymaker and saw the advantages as well as the downsides of the trends and the vehicles and the instruments that we discussed? How would you go about regulating or formulating policy around them to make sure that the benefits are maintained, but the downsides are mitigated? And we talked about, banning shell companies and so on and so forth. So, but what would your key three priorities be?
Yeah, so I think I discuss it at the end of my book. I'm basically saying we have to roll back the, I think what I think are excessive abilities of people to outsource the law and use the law from different types of jurisdictions to code their capital, and stands in direct tension with our ability to exercise democratic self-governance. So I think democratic self-governance, to be able to set the rules of the game for our own societies, is critical. You can do this at the EU level or the national level, but we have to have some control over that. So I think, as I suggest in my book, I think there should be limits on the ability to pick and choose the law that you want, greater limits than we currently have. I think there should be greater limitations or greater scrutiny of using private arbitration tribunals to resolve these disputes without any public scrutiny, because the parties can then have it all private and nobody really knows about it and doesn't become part of our private deliberation. So I think if the courts are then called upon to enforce them, the current rule is that they should just execute without really looking at the merits of the ruling. And that's fine for many types of transactions, but I think there's also a public policy exception in the New York Convention, which says, you know, you might be able to look at the merits if it violates your public policy. We should be a bit more aggressive on that and interpret public policy in a broader fashion than it has been in the past. So these are the kind of measures. They're nuanced. There's not one silver bullet, but I think the bottom line of that is we have to make sure that the control over when states lend their coercive enforcement powers to private organizations and the private use of law has to be ultimately a public call and not just a private call. We can't just piggyback on our coercive powers. Law is public good. The ability to enforce is a public good. They're using it for private purposes and to a point where they basically undermine the stability of our system. That's where we have to draw a wedge and gain control over both lawmaking and law enforcement.
And maybe the experience of that financial and economic crisis has changed sensitivities as well, because now the primacy of politics as an expression of the public interest is probably accepted. And you saw pushback, for instance, against investor protection elements of TTIP, which is, if I understand this correctly, one way of saying this is just benefiting private interests at the expense of the public.
Exactly. Totally with you on that one. Yes. And I think there is greater public awareness. And we see responses in the European-Canadian treaty where they sort of create a new type of court where you don't only have private arbiters, but you have more public appointees. And I know it's also criticized, but I think it's a major step in the right direction from where I come from.
Okay. Well, the ground is shifting. That's definitely an area to keep an eye on. Katharina Pistor, thank you very much indeed for taking the time to talk to me about this. And I hope we can catch up about these issues at a later stage, because I think there's a lot of development coming up.
Great. Thank you so much for having me. I really appreciate it. It was great to talk to you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for listening. We hope you enjoyed it. Make sure you don't miss future episodes by subscribing to Social Europe Podcast. You can also read our articles on www.socialeurope.eu and follow us on Facebook and on Twitter @Social Europe. Until next time.